Got one? That's good. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the third annual New Zealand Wine Day, brought to you on behalf of Complexity Fine Wines. Is everyone having a great time so far? Yeah. Enjoying your wine? That's what I like to hear. I'm your host and certified sommelier of Wine Channel TV, Jess Altieri. I'm so excited you could join us because today we're essentially bringing New Zealand to you. I don't know if you know, but New Zealand is one of the most beautiful places to visit. I actually went there this past January for their Pinot 2013 conference. So not only is it stunning, but they're known for their amazing high-quality wines that you're going to get to taste and learn about tonight. So to give you an overview of the evening, we're going to be tasting through 15 stunning wineries from 6 different regions, covering 7 different grape varietals of New Zealand. First, we're going to cover a fantastic flight of white wines. Then we'll have a short break featuring New Zealand-inspired cuisine, where I'll speak with Chef Billy Kim, and we have specially flown in New Zealand Cervena venison and Ora King salmon, so you guys are going to love it. And then we'll end with a flight of red wine. So it's going to be fantastic, and I have to give a big special thanks to everyone joining us virtually as well, because everyone's watching us live stream right now, so from New Zealand and around the world. Hello, everybody. But without further ado, let's welcome out my co-host for the evening, who's joining us all the way from New Zealand tonight. He is a 20-plus year veteran in the wine industry, world-renowned winemaker from Seresin Estate. Let's give a big welcome for Clive Dougall.
Thank you.
Great to see you, Clive.
Thank you. Thanks for a lovely welcome.
Yeah, of course. Anything for you. This is for you, of course, a glass of bubbles.
Thank you very much.
How are you enjoying the Windy City? This is your first time out here. Is everyone treating you okay?
I've been totally surprised. I had no idea. It's sort of like a hidden secret. It was it's really open city, friendly, beautiful place to be. Loving it.
I love that. You've been all around town in only 2 days.
That's right.
That's perfect.
They've been working me hard.
That's how it should be. And since we all can't join you in New Zealand, like I said, I'm so glad you could join us here today. Tell everyone about your background, though, just a little bit before we get started, because I know you've been in the wine industry and you're so modest, but over 20 years, and he's not even originally from New Zealand, though. That's where that accent comes from.
Yeah, that's right. So you might understand me a little bit more than some Kiwis that you come across. I'm actually an Englishman, and I know I don't look old enough, but I have actually been working in wine for 20 years. Quick story, my mum threw me out of home at the age of 18 because I didn't repay her investment in my very expensive private school, let's put it that way. I was too interested in smoking dope and drinking. And so my first job was in a wine store at the age of 18, and I just fell in love with it from then. So one day a winemaker walked into this wine shop I was running, and I had an epiphany, and I thought, that's what I'm going to do. So I left London and went to New Zealand, and I haven't left. So that was 15 years ago.
And how long have you been with Seresin Estate then now?
I've been there for 8 years.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
And I've worked at a few other wineries in New Zealand. I've worked at Vavasor and Pegasus Bay as well. But yeah, I'm at Seresin and I'm not going anywhere. I wouldn't give that job up for the world.
Well, I love it. Well, we're honored to have you here today.
Thank you.
Get the party officially started, of course, with some bubbles.
Sure.
And so a little cheers.
Oh,
toast.
Cheers.
Sorry,
thank
you. Snipping it away.
That's all
here
right.
We have some fantastic sparkling wine, and this is from Quartz Reef Winery in central Otago, New Zealand. I know they're one of the fastest growing wine regions in New Zealand. Can you talk about this? We have winemaker Rudy Bauer there, who does a phenomenal job year in and year out.
Yeah, I mean, to your first point is absolutely right. It's one of the fastest growing, but the great thing about it is limited, so it can't get big, you know. It's a very, very unique area where they have to find a little bit of soil here and there, literally perched on the side of a mountain sometimes to make it work. Rudy Bauer is a real pioneer. He's worked all over New Zealand, but he bought some land in central Otago, I think about 15, 18 years ago, as a site that he thought was going to be special. And it didn't get planted immediately. And he's developed this area of Bendigo, which is right near a beautiful lake. Lake Cromwell there. He's a great guy.
And a cool story, if you're wondering about the name, it's actually believed to have the largest deposit of quartz beneath the vineyards at Bendigo Station at the Quartz Reef Winery, so that's where they get the name from. And I love this wine, because if you even smell it, you get almost like a hint of orange blossom and a little bit of, I say, oyster shell, which sounds crazy, but you get that aroma on the nose. And then when you take a sip, you get that crisp minerality, a little bit of brioche and like gala apple. Be perfect with oysters.
It would. I mean, it's Chardonnay-based, and you can tell that it's got that beautiful richness that Chardonnay gives you, I think. He hand riddles and disgorges every bottle of wine. Yeah, it's an amazing process. Delicious wine. Probably, in my eyes, the best in New Zealand,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, and so that ties into our second wine we have here tonight. It's also from central Otago, the Amesfield Pinot Gris with winemaker Stephanie Lambert. I love our female winemaker, sorry. And I love this wine. It's very, very crisp and refreshing. You get almost the nice, I would say, like quince and pear and spicy ginger aromas. We get that nice minerality on the finish as well. But the cool thing about this winery, they're very sustainable. Talk to us about that. I know they're the first, it's a mouthful, wetland winery wastewater recycling plant.
This is
a big thing in New Zealand.
I can't say that, I'm sorry. No, they are. I mean, sustainability is really important to everybody in New Zealand. They've got this great thing. I mean, we shouldn't just be talking about their wastewater because the wine's absolutely delicious too. But I mean, this thing's incredible, very, very inventive. The wastewater tumbles down the side of this mountain, aerates, and then it goes through this reed bed, and it helps to regenerate some land that, you know, wasn't very healthy before. Really, really special thing. Great producer, absolutely amazing restaurant. If ever you go to Central Otago, you've got to go to the restaurant. It's on the Lake Hayes, right on the lake. That's absolutely stunning.
All right, that's on my list next time.
Yeah.
The third wine we have is also a Pinot Gris. I'll give this to you.
Oh, thanks.
This is from Mud House, and I have to give a big special thanks because they put up with me and hosted me for a few weeks when I was out in New Zealand. Had the best time with them. And this is a fantastic wine, though, from the Waipara Valley. And this also has the nice, almost pear and quince notes on the nose and that crisp minerality finish to it. But talk about the difference, because this one's from Waipara Valley versus the Central Otago.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a little bit of something else confusing it as well. The Otago wine has a little bit of oak aging on the way through to the bottle. But really the difference is, in my eyes, Waipara Valley is a mixture of sort of gravelly soil, not such sort of hard, schisty soil that they have in mineral soil down in Central. And also there's limestone deposits around there, and I think that mineral character really comes through in this wine. Yeah, it's a really amazing region. It's really a struggle for people to make a living there in a way, because it's right on the edge of kind of the weather. It gets a lot of bad weather at certain times of the year, but you know, generally the best wines are made in places where they can only just do it. So
that's true. Yeah. And so now we're going to tie into the fourth wine. It's a little bit different. Here we have the Highfield Riesling. Highfield actually gets the name from the Walsh family, who originated from Ireland, and this is a small area near their hometown called Highfield. Yeah. But I love this wine. It has that nice sweetness to it. It has almost
delicious.
A orange blossom, honey, and peach note aroma to it, a crisp medium finish. It would be great with like a spicy dish, like here at Ballyquir, or the dishes you'll be sampling later. But talk to us about Riesling. Is this a more up-and-coming trend, you think, from New Zealand?
I see it happening. I mean, you know, everyone talks about Riesling being the next big thing, always. Certainly, I know there's a lot more demand coming through the Marlborough wineries. That's where I'm based, so I have a bit more information on that. But people are looking for more Riesling, planting a bit more Riesling now. And, you know, as a winemaker, every winemaker loves Riesling more than anything, almost, in terms of white wine. And it's really exciting to see it happen. You know, this is a great producer of Riesling, great bubbles producer as well, and certainly Sauvignon Blanc. The winemaker, Al Soper. His daughter is actually pretty much best friends with my daughter.
Oh,
two little 4-year-olds, so you know, it's a big family up there.
I like stories like that.
Yeah.
And all right, the next set of wines that we have here today are really what put New Zealand on the map. When you think of New Zealand, usually you think of Sauvignon Blanc. With its nose, I would say ranging from, I would say grass and green beans to almost gooseberry and grapefruit. And the first one we have here has a really cool story behind the name as well, the Spy Valley Envoy Sauvignon Blanc. Talk to us about this, because there was an American spy base up the road from the winery.
It's Spy Valley is based, is in the Waihopai Valley. And it, I guess, you know, some people have called it the Spy Valley in the past. There's literally these two great big white balls sitting in the middle of the valley. They're amazing, like huge golf balls. I mean, they're as big as, they're probably 10 stories high or something like that. And inside each one of them, there's a huge, kind of like a satellite dish, I guess. An American spy base. I guess Envoy is a pun on that for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, delicious wine. That one's barrel fermented. You can taste it. It's a totally different expression. These are three really serious Sauvignon Blancs, we've got to say. These aren't, you know, the big brand, kind of big blends from the big brands. Unique little wines, I think, very special, yeah.
It is. That's, again, very refreshing. You get that nice gooseberry, I would say grapefruit, and a little bit of grassy aromas to that with that crisp minerality kind of finish. A little bit zingy, though. That's typical for New Zealand. And that ties us into the next wine where you actually worked at, Vevasor. Tell us about that. I can't believe, how long were you there for?
It was sort of like when I was just studying to be a winemaker, or just before I was studying. Like I worked as a sommelier, and I used to take my annual leave to go and do harvest at Vevasor. They are the pioneers, the first people in the Awatere Valley. The Awatere Valley is the valley just over the mountains on the way to Christchurch if you left Blenheim. The first people to plant those. The guy there, Stu Marfel, who makes the wine, you know, I sort of laugh because I'm not sure he's ever left the valley. His family come from there. There's a beach called Marfel's Beach. He was born there. His mum worked at the winery in the vineyard, and then Stuart, when he went to university, you know, of course he knew them very well because his mum worked there, and they're down the road, and he ended up getting the winemaker's job there. So a really cool guy. There's no one that knows more about that area, I would say, than Stu.
I love that. And the last Sauvignon Blanc that we have here is Nautilus, which I'm sure you've seen. I would say that's, I've read at least, one of New Zealand's most premium, consistent Sauvignon Blancs that you see in a lot of places.
Yeah.
And here we have winemaker Clive Jones, who always does a phenomenal job. Talk to us about the Sauvignon Blanc, though, because the three are from Marlborough, but there are differences between the wines, even though they're all Sauvignon Blanc.
I'm glad you asked. because, you know, I think that Marlborough Sauvignon Blanc has so much more to offer than a lot of people realize. These are from the three valleys, really. I mean, we call the Southern Valleys the Waihopai, the Omako, and the Brancott Valley, the Awatere Valley, where the Vavasor one came from. And the Nautilus comes from more the Wairau Valley, so it's on the flat there, the main valley surrounded by mountains. I think you can see a real difference, particularly in the last two there. Not so much the Envoy, because it's a different style, stylistically different. It doesn't show the, you know, just what the soil is showing.
Right.
It's a winemaker's expression. With the other two, I think the Nautilus, for sure, has more tropical fruit character. You know, it's certainly a little richer and softer compared to the Vavasor, which has that amazing acidity and that kind of real herbaceous edge to it. And that those two wines really do show you that it does matter where you grow grapes in Marlborough.
What would be your perfect pairing with those Sauvignon Blancs in New Zealand if we were there?
It's got to be seafood, you know.
Of course, oysters, scallops.
Oysters, scallops, we would say. mussels, for sure. All seafood, absolutely. A lot of people work Sauvignon Blanc with roasted vegetables, goat's cheese, and things like that. Really helps to cut through that. That works really well.
Okay, yeah. I like that. Well, beyond Sauvignon Blanc, New Zealand has fantastic, very cool climate, I would say, refined Chardonnays. They're almost Burgundian in style.
Yeah.
So what that means is it's not like your big, bold Australian or California type of Chardonnays. And we're going to touch on that a little bit. So the first wine we have right here, the Chardonnay, is the Kumeo River. And it was founded by the Brockovich family in 1944. And here we have Master of Wine, Michael Brockovich, who was one of the first Masters of Wine from New Zealand.
Yeah.
And so talk to us about the Chardonnay in comparison to U.S. style.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think it's a lot more refined, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly it's a cool climate. You know, we've got to keep telling people that. We're not Australia, you know. We live on the edge of making grapes or not. We have massive vintage variation, which is obviously a good thing in wine. And I'd say that the great thing about Chardonnay is all the way down the country, whether it's in Auckland, which, you know, they don't make a lot of wine in Auckland, but this is one of the best wines in the whole of New Zealand. All the way down Hawke's Bay, Martinborough, Marlborough, I don't want to miss anybody else, that Waipara and Central Otago, Nelson, thanks, sorry, Nelson. everywhere it makes great Chardonnay, and they're all different. And I mean, that's what great wine's about, especially Chardonnay, expressing the place. They vary in fruit character, they vary in minerality, acidity. It's something that a lot of people get very, very excited about for the first time when they try New Zealand Chardonnay.
And I want to ask you guys in the audience, do you notice a trend about any of the bottles? Well, besides this one, what do you notice? Screw top, exactly. So talk to us about that, because I know that they were members of the International Screw Cap Initiative. That's all the rage in New Zealand.
Yeah.
I mean, that's it.
It is. And I just want to quickly say about why we did it as well, if that's all right.
Yeah, I would love to.
Because, you know, it's not a cost thing at all. People must realize that this is just for quality purposes. At the end of the day, New Zealand is at the bottom of the world. You know, the next stop is Antarctica. And so the corks come from the Northern Hemisphere. And, you know, little old New Zealand in the late 90s, early 2000s, you know, they weren't exactly important to the cork producers.
Right.
So the good corks went to Burgundy and Bordeaux and started coming down California, you know, started coming down south. And then at the end of the day, the Australians would get them. They probably sift through what they want and gave us all the crap, you know. So we literally found that we were losing half a case, like pretty much 50% for some producers.
Wow.
in bad bottles. And that's just not acceptable, you know.
Yeah.
So it's a quality purpose thing. And Michael Brockovich was right at the forefront of that fight. There was a few wineries that got together, and it was amazing how the whole country got behind it. Really amazing. And yeah, in the early days, I've got to say, the Americans were the most conservative.
Right.
And I know that Michael for sure would have bottled some under screw cap and some under cork. We did at Seresin as well. And you know, nowadays we've just said, we're not playing that game with anymore. And it's accepted. There's no problem. You know, there's $150 bottles of wine with screw caps from New Zealand.
That's very interesting. Are there any other trends that you see for white wines as we're concluding the first white wine flight from New Zealand? I know aromatics is huge for you guys.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. It doesn't almost feel right, but you can grow Riesling, you can grow Pinot Gris, you can grow Gewürztraminer, Viognier. There's now people planting Grunewaldiner, Arneis. You know, it's just that it's such a diverse environment, and there's so many different sites. It's a very long, thin country. So it stretches a lot of zones, temperate zones. And yeah, the white wines are amazing. The red wines, obviously, we'll try them later. Some exciting new varietals coming in there as well. It's a young, dynamic industry. And you know, you can see that, I think. So.
No, it's really exciting. And so I hope you guys enjoyed so far learning about the white wines. This is only the first half of the show. And I got to thank everyone that's joining us virtually so far. I know we have some of the winemakers joining us, tweeting away. I think Michael Bragovich and Stephanie Lambert and some other people coming up later on in the show.
I think Matt Dicey as well. There's a few of them watching. So hopefully they'll be putting their questions through to us.
Oh, yeah. And if you're curious about where to buy the wines, I should say online as well. It's, what is it, wine@complexity.co.nz. We'll have a sign up later for you guys.
Yeah.
But right now, enjoy. You're going to have a short little break to try some especially prepared New Zealand cuisine that Chef Bill Kim prepared for you, featuring cervena venison and Ora King salmon. And you're going to enjoy the red wines, then join me back here in a few minutes, and we'll tell you all about them. So enjoy. Cheers.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Alrighty. Cheers. I'm going to head back.
All right.
There he is, the chef of the hour. How are you, chef? Oh, wait, I'm giving you this glass. You're hard at work. You need it. That's all I have to say. How are you? Great to see you.
Great to see you.
Third annual New Zealand Wine Day. Can you believe it already?
Third time. Oh, my God.
Time flies.
It does.
I love working with you, though. It's always the best. Always a big smile on your face.
Yeah.
Tell me what's going on. In case people that are joining us virtually, they want to know, where are we in Chicago? Tell me about Belly Q.
Well, we're hard at Randolph Street, so... It's been,
a couple years since we opened up
like seven restaurants on the street.
Seven restaurants, yeah.
Yeah, so we're on the street, and it's been 9 months. The restaurant's called Belly Q.
Right.
And it's our interpretation of modern Asian barbecue.
And, okay, so Chef is really modest, but he's a legendary chef, not only in Chicago, but across the country. I just saw the 10-page spread of you in Food & Wine magazine with him and his beautiful wife, Yvonne. Yeah, oh my gosh. But you guys are doing really, really big things, and it's exciting.
Yeah, yeah, and we're going to keep on trying to turn the wheels and do things that are different to our industry, so it's an honor and it's a pleasure to be here.
And tell me again about the cuisine here. I mean, I think it's so cool when you walk in, you have the grills at your table, you can fire things up.
So we like to have people be interactive, so we have these great Japanese infrared grills that are imported from Japan, took us almost a year to get. We have eight tables that people could cook on themselves, and also we have these great pizza ovens that we make Korean pancakes out of.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yes.
I love it all. And there's karaoke for late night.
There is.
But beyond all that, your cuisine, I think, is a perfect match for New Zealand wine. And that's what we're talking about tonight. And you prepared two special dishes. Right now, let's talk about the salmon first. I want to talk about this.
Sure.
They both look beautiful, but let's first talk about the salmon, because I know it would go perfectly with a lot of the wines we have here today. And it's the Ora King salmon. So
it
is. It's really unique to New Zealand.
And I don't know. Well, right here.
Oh, I love it. Get in the kitchen.
Look at this thing.
Look at that guy.
We'll just put it right down right here.
I love this. Are you kidding me?
Oh my God.
So this is from New Zealand. I know later on we're going to talk with the specialist of Ora King salmon and talk to us how they're bred and hand selected.
Yeah.
But this is unbelievably beautiful.
It's you know what? It's an honor. It's almost like it's catalog of fish. And, and you could see just how it is. And it's nice and firm.
Wow.
And we just took it. We did as little as possible. We just kind of marinated, put lemongrass on there.
Yeah.
I went to the farmer's market today, so we got French radish.
So fresh.
I know.
Oh my God. Okay, so fresh radish. And what's the sauce on top that you have there?
The sauce is just basically kefir lime, a little bit of brown sugar, and wild watercress.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You know, it's complicated, but not. It's like so simple, it's refreshing. It's like a perfect, I would say, complement to the salmon, not overpowering.
Yes. You know, the pairing, just the salmon is so elegant and rich, so we thought we kind of offset that by adding radishes and also lemongrass.
Have you used this Ora King salmon before?
I have.
Oh, you have?
Yeah, and it's just one of those things that when I touch it, my knife just kind of glides through it. It's a beautiful thing.
All right, I can't wait to try that. Yeah. I'm guessing it'd be a perfect pairing because you said with a little marinade in the sauce with like a nice Pinot Gris or Sauvignon Blanc.
Exactly.
From New Zealand tonight. Done and done. All right, so we're talking about the salmon. Time to bring in the salmon specialist. Thanks, Chef. I'll get back to you in a second.
You're welcome.
You can enjoy your wine for a second.
All right, take care.
Coming in here. Ori, great to see you, man. How are you? All right, so this big bad boy, you got to tell me all about. I know, so Ori King salmon, it's a unique breed of king salmon from New Zealand. Talk to me about this.
So basically, Chef Bill Kim led us into it really well. Our king salmon comes from the Marlborough Sounds.
Right.
Really pristine water. These beautiful fish are nurtured their whole way through. They start off in fresh water and then they're transported out to the seawater. The Marlborough Sounds, like you mentioned, is a ideal place for wine growing, and it's also an ideal place for king salmon. We've got really cold water, very high tidal flows, so there's lots of current. It's just an ideal place to grow king salmon.
And I have to mention, I saw, because I'm a total geek about this stuff, I watched the video online on your website. It was so cool because it did show the actual transplant of the salmon to the Marlborough Sounds and everywhere, and how you guys hand select them, and you guys, it's in the factory, and they're numbering them and slicing them. Talk to us about that. So they are all hand selected.
Yeah, so they are hand selected. One thing that I do want to touch on is that what makes our salmon unique, it's a king salmon. We can trace back the original salmon to the Sacramento River, which is pretty neat. And then they moved over to New Zealand. Our fish are fed non-GMO feed, no vaccines, no antibiotics, which is very important these days.
Yeah.
And then, like you touched on the hand selection process, Ori King goes through many levels of grading.
Right.
And these fish are impeccable.
Got
One cool thing about it is that they've got really small heads, a very tail, very, very thick belly section.
A lot of meat.
Lots of meat, lots of usable yield for chefs, and it's just a beautiful silver color, which is perfect.
And so, I mean, can you really tell the difference? Like, if people watching virtually, tell me if you had to do, like, taste division, what's the taste that you get if you're in a restaurant and you can tell? Is it just so much more delicate, so much more smooth?
It is. It's velvety in terms of texture. It's velvety, whether it's raw or cooked. Yeah, I mean, go for it. Whether it's raw or cooked, it's really luxurious.
Oh, really? I don't even know you. No. I love it. But that's good stuff. That's fantastic. Wow. It is almost like the buttery, like, it just melts in your mouth.
It's got really high oil content.
Ooh.
And it's supreme.
So the last thing I want to know is, where can people find this? Is it mostly in grocery stores, restaurants, or not yet in grocery stores?
It's going to be at all the high-end restaurants throughout the country. Here in Chicago, we're talking about restaurants like Belly Q, Spiaggia, L2O, really high-end, high-caliber restaurants.
Got it.
Ask your chef to get it in. It's very easy to get.
And where can people find more information? What's your website?
OraKingSalmon.com is our website. Online, you can get it at CatalinaOP.com.
Oh, okay.
They sell it as well.
Easy enough. Yep. All right, should I give this to you? Now it's time to get out of here. Now it's time to talk about the venison. Yeah, take your salmon. But we're going to meet up with Chef. Chef, come on over here. Oh, I'll give you. You could just toss it to him. What the heck? Come on over here.
All right.
Sorry, we had to steal a couple pieces.
Oh, my God.
I was just, like, dying. It's so good. Okay, now we're getting into the meat. Talk to me about the Cervena venison that we got here all the way from New Zealand. Have you used this before?
25 years.
25 years?
Yes.
Get out.
Yes.
So
I swear to God.
So, I love this.
I mean, it's one of those things. It's so consistent. It's velvety, creamy. Also, it's earthy to me.
Right.
It's a consistent product that I always, you know.
And if you're talking to people about the venison, trying to describe it if they've never had it before, what kind of meat do you compare it to, taste-wise? Because I'm sure a lot of people, not a lot of people have had venison. I mean, well, New Zealand, yes. But in the States, everyone watching virtually, I'm sure not all of them.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very lean kind of meat.
Right.
I don't know if you could compare it to anything, but the Cervena venison is very mild. And it doesn't have that really gamey taste that people are acquired to in a wild animal. So I love to use this product, and we just kind of marinated in red wine. And
tell me how you prepared this special dish right here. Yeah.
We actually marinated in red wine for 2 days.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so obviously
perfect
the pairing is
the
very,
and all of it,
Then we tea-smoked it.
Okay,
which is an Asian way of kind of bringing out the flavor. Then little hummus.
Right.
Our chickpea hummus and little
chickpea
fried
hummus. That's hummus, yes, on top of the. Yeah. Great pairing. Yeah. I like that. And then the fried chickpea.
Yes.
I like that. Well, actually, yeah, I should just take a whole bite.
There you
try
go.
Try it with the hummus. Oh my god, it's so good. With the crunchiness of the chickpea.
Yes.
Is this something people could find on your menu, or?
You know what? I kind of created this for the tasting. So something different that we have, but.
Perfect pairing.
Yes.
I love it. Now it's time to bring in the specialist behind the venison. Thanks
all right
so much, Chef.
You're
we'll
welcome.
You in a couple minutes. How are you, Brad? Hey, great to see you. Sorry, my mouth's full.
No worries.
You need to try a piece, I think.
Absolutely. Well, I'm not going to talk with my mouth full.
I do. Okay. Sorry, that's my job.
Alrighty.
But no, this is unbelievable. And I know that venison, it wasn't even originally native to New Zealand.
No, it was brought in the 1800s by the British.
And now, yeah, and I know the cool meaning behind cervena, actually the Latin word for deer combined with venison. I like that. Talk to us about it.
Cervena is Latin for deer.
Deer, yeah.
And venison is Latin for hunter.
Right.
But they've combined, you know, red meat, deer.
And so talk to us about this in New Zealand now, because this is...
It's farm-raised. It's the food of royalty.
Right.
It's farm-raised. There's about 2,500 venison farmers in New Zealand. About 1,500 of which are cervena certified.
Oh.
Basically, it's anything from 200 to 2,000 acres, lush green grasses, no antibiotics, no hormones, never been in a feedlot.
Oh.
You know, it's...
I know there are certain requirements. That's what I was reading. Grass-fed only, grass, and they have to be around under 3 years of age. Talk about that.
It's grasses and forages only, because
right
in the winter months, you got to supplement it with hay and silage.
Okay.
It's 3 years or under. Harvested in the venison-only facility to reduce the stress of the animal.
Got it.
You know, it's just... It's nature's buffet, basically.
I like the way you say that. And the other thing that I've been reading about is, because we were talking about sustainability with the wines, that's right, a really big thing. I know the venison, it has a really low carbon footprint. Because even though it's coming from New Zealand, people think that it'd be, but it's not, because it's overseas, right?
Absolutely. A truck filled with cattle going from
right
coast to coast
right
has more carbon emission
that's
than
right
a container coming from a sea freight container.
Unbelievable.
The benefit to that is because all meat needs to be aged to get
okay
the energies out of the muscle to make it nice and tender.
Right.
It ages on the sea freight on the way over.
Oh my God,
so
what a great process.
When it gets to the distributor and the customer,
yeah,
it's as tender as what you just ate.
That's, and that is really juicy, really tender. So I was asking Chef, and that's what I want to know from you, if you're talking to someone new about venison, what do you usually compare it to, meat-wise, if there's another texture? I mean, I know it's hard, but taste-wise,
you know what,
or in between anything.
To me, venison has a taste of its own. People have a perception that venison is only for fall and winter months.
Right.
But venison is 12 months out of the year. It's very clean, very smooth flavor profile, so you could put any kind of flavor influence
okay
with it. You cook it to a medium rare, let it sit for a few minutes.
That's medium
rare.
Then
come up to a medium. Like I said, it's
like
a food
heaven,
of royalty.
Heaven on a plate.
Right.
And the last thing I was asking before with the salmon is this venison, is it predominantly found in restaurants right now, grocery stores? Where can people find it?
You know, you'll find it primarily in high end restaurants. You'll find it in some supermarkets.
Okay.
And slowly but surely, it's finding its way, because today more than ever, people care about the farm to fork.
We care about
the food.
Farm to foot, that's the big thing, yeah.
We care about the food that we eat. We want to know the story behind it. We want to know if these animals, you know, eat it, you know, nature's buffet.
Right.
We want to know that there's no harm on the animal, it's good for the environment, and most of all, it's good for us.
Right. And lastly, what's your website if people want to go visit online, or else they can just Google Cervena Venison and they find out more information?
Cervena.com.
Cervena.com, easy enough. Thank you so much.
Thank
I appreciate
you.
It. Now you can have a piece. It's unbelievable.
There you go. Cheers.
I love it. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to meet right back up with Chef one more time. Did he run away? There he is. He's busy at work. I'm stealing him. I'm sorry, Chef.
It's
I know
okay.
You have a restaurant to run to. Besides coming on over here for
yes.
New Zealand Wine Day. So I need to know, though, what's in the future for you? I mean, you're doing some really big things, I hear.
Yeah.
Expanding?
Expanding eventually. We have our retail sauce line that we're doing, Urban Belly Foods.
Wow. What's it called? Is it called Belly?
It's Urban Belly Foods. We have Belly Smoke, Belly Fire, line of hot sauces, line of barbecue sauces.
Nice.
Hopefully more restaurants down
to
the
come.
Future. Yes.
It's You got to stay tuned. And what's your website if people want to visit, or they'll say Google Belly Q?
Sure. You could do a couple different websites. We have three restaurants, so urbanbellychicago.com. You have bellyshackchicago.com.
I forgot about all
then bellyqchicago.com.
It's taking over the world. So, yeah. I love it. Thanks, Shaq.
Thank you.
You're the best. I appreciate it. All right, now I'm going to head back over there. Hopefully Clive didn't drink all the red wine, because now it's time to talk about all the fantastic red wine
flights.
I'll save you a glass. All right, we'll meet you back over there in a few. Hey, Jesse, can I ask you a favor? Because I have to go right back out there. Any food or anything?
No, you're all good. The mic is sticking over here.
Oh. Everybody out now, but I'm gonna grab some people. Wait, Clive, you hold down the fort
yeah,
right now.
I can hold.
I want to wave everybody back in here.
Okay,
the show.
You get them.
Wait, Clive, don't drink all the wine.
No. I am thirsty though. But I don't know.
Come on
They're
back
amazing.
In.
Beautiful.
Bring everybody back in. Can you usher everyone back in, please?
Can you calm the
food? Ready.
Come on in.
Yeah, you are. Take a seat, sir, if you don't mind, please. Thank you. Yeah, that's cool. Anyway. I'm live. Okay, cool. Oh, well, that's good. Thanks for putting me on the spot. That's sweet. No worries. Well, I can talk about these wines if you want. Well, on my own. We don't need Jess. I couldn't squeeze into that dress myself, I must say. And those shoes definitely wouldn't fit. But here she comes, the real host.
All right. Trying to round everybody
That's
up.
Cool. We're live anyways.
We got all of our gorgeous people all sipping out there.
They wanted me to hold the fort. I said I couldn't wear your shoes. That was it. And I certainly wouldn't fit in. And I certainly wouldn't fit into that dress either.
Yes, you could. Oh, it's fine. They're all busy, but that's a good thing. They're relaxing. Yeah. They're enjoying all the fantastic red wine.
we're not going to get into it just yet. Okay. I'm glad you didn't drink it while I was in the kitchen.
No, I have been tempted though.
Did you try any of the morsels? The cervain of venison and the working salmon?
Yeah, unbelievable.
Phenomenal.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I had never had that, and honestly, it was like butter
the
in my
Savannah
mouth.
The Savannah or the?
Well, both. It was really good. But I love that salmon. I'm a salmon fiend. The Mudhouse people know. Everyone watching virtually from New Zealand knows. Everywhere I went in New Zealand, I got the salmon.
I got a good idea while we're waiting. Where's that sign for the? We need the.
Oh, there,
I can hold up the sign where we can help you find this wine as well. Well, that's a good idea. Here we go. Look.
His
that's
sign.
What it is. It's like
don't
the
you
sign.
Love his handwriting?
It's very traditional. I actually did write that, yeah. That's very professional, I know. Wine at complexity.co.nz. Not NZ, I know, but NZ. There you go. Don't forget it.
It's too funny. Everyone will remember.
Everyone will remember it. That's it. They
We're
got
good.
It.
I'll put it on now.
Good to see you all coming back.
All right, we'll get started because it looks like everybody's almost back here right now. Welcome back, everybody, again to the third annual New Zealand Wine Day brought to you by Complexity Fine Wines. We're the second half of our show. I'm Jess Altieri, your host with Wine Channel TV, joined by the one and only Clive Dougall of Seresin Estate. So we took you through earlier a fantastic flight of white wines. Now it's all everything red. I know Pinot is the next big thing for New Zealand. Talk to me about it because it's small on a world scale, but I know you guys have amazing vines that are just coming to age, really.
Yeah, I think Pinot Noir is very, very exciting for New Zealand. You know, Pinot Noir is that beautiful grape. You can't grow it everywhere. You know, so where it grows is always a special place. You know, where I think obviously you have some in North America, some in Europe, a little bit in Germany as well as, you know, as well as France, a touch in South America and New Zealand. You know, they're the only places. It's this little narrow band of around the world of latitude that you can grow Pinot Noir. And of course, it's an amazing variety to express individuality and individual places that it comes from. And that's right. Why it works so well in New Zealand, because there's all these different amazing terroir everywhere, you know?
There is, and people may not know, I mean, the New Zealand wine industry is still very young. When did it start? The 60s, not even around
there. It started in Michael Brakovich would disagree.
He was before, but, I know. But every book I've read was
But basically forever. The modern New Zealand wine industry started in the 80s.
The modern.
You know, the government paid the growers to pull the vines out the ground and plant some decent varieties. They had all sorts of things like Müller-Thurgau, Silvana, things
Come
like
on
that.
In. Here's the party. They're late. Come on in. They're enjoying the wine. I love it. Get on in here. We got some more of the gang following
yeah,
in.
Yeah, some coming in.
Don't worry, we're starting with the red wine.
It's very, very young. Pinot Noir has been grown for around 30 years in New Zealand. As you say, Jess, there's some vine age coming in. I know most producers have 20, some 30, some 15-year-old vines, and that's making a huge difference.
And so let's start off with the first wine we have here, Cloudy Bay, Marlborough Pinot Noir. So wait, here's your glass.
Thank you.
With winemakers, then Timmy and Sarah Burton. Sarah was with us last year. We miss her. Hey, Sarah, I hope you're joining us virtually. But I love this Pinot. It has almost wonderful wild strawberry, a little bit of raspberry, and I would say cherry aroma. It's a little bit of floral notes with that spicy tobacco note on the palate.
Yeah.
And I mean, is that something characteristically you'd find for Pinot Noir from Marlborough?
Yeah, I think that's a good way of wrapping it up in a way. I mean, obviously there's different sites within Marlborough as well. I mean, the first two wines actually are grown on vineyards that just have a fence between them.
Oh.
The Seresin vineyard was planted in, I think, 1998, 1999. The cloudy one maybe 4 or 5 years later, so it's a good comparison to taste those two. Basically, I would say the more exciting Pinot Noirs coming out of these valleys at the southern end of Marlborough nowadays, they've got clay soils as opposed to the stony riverbeds that you find on the main valley. That's not to say they don't make great wine from there. You know, we make some single vineyard wines down there as well, and a lot of people do, but that's the really special parts now.
I like that, and a cool story. I love the stories behind the name. So I know, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but the bay at the eastern end of the Wairau Valley was named Cloudy Bay by Captain Cook on his voyage to New Zealand in 1770. Is that true, or is it something I read?
I'll go with that.
I think it's true. I'm a nerd. Say it's true, I read too, everything. You know. All right, so that ties into our next wine. This is your baby. I'll let you take that away. Seresin. But the only thing I want to make sure you touch on is the handprint, because I think that's so significant on the front and how I always notice your wine bottle from afar.
Well, thank you. It's, look, I got to say that a lot of people don't remember the name Seresin. It's an unusual name. They do remember the hand always. And often when I talk to people, where do you work? Seresin. They look at you. I go, you know, the one with the hand. Oh, yeah, I love that wine. Yeah. It's great. And in fact, there are some places in the world in restaurants where they just hold their hand up to the waiter. It's like, yeah, and that means I'll have another bottle of Seresin to the table, please. We're owned by one man, Michael Seresin. He's a very famous New Zealand filmmaker. He's still active. He's filming Planet of the Apes in 3D right now in New Orleans. And He's 70 now, and he's made movies for about 40 years, I guess. He was the cameraman on the Sgt. Pepper's Mystery Tour video. He made Midnight Express, Angel Heart, Harry Potter, The Prisoner of Azkaban. You name it, Michael Seresin's been involved with it. He set it up to be a great, like a Tuscan estate where we have food, we have animals on the property, we make olive oil, fully certified biodynamic. He's a great man.
So I got to visit the next time I'm
you
up there.
Definitely. I can't believe you came and you didn't
I know,
visit.
I'm sorry, shame on me. Next time I'll be back. Yeah. All right, and so the next two wines, those are from Marlborough. The next two are actually from Martinborough. Yeah. Starting off with TK, or how do you properly pronounce it in New Zealand?
Tekaranga.
Tekaranga.
But TK is what actually it's known as by us as well, because that's a mouthful, obviously.
It's one of Martinborough's founding vineyards. Tell me more about this.
Yeah,
they've been around.
Tekaranga and Atarangi, the next wine, both of them have been around for, I guess, up around 30 years, probably a bit more. A great winery that, you know, has a place in New Zealand history there. I always had a soft spot for TK as a sommelier in Wellington. They used to have this wonderful golf day where you'd go and they'd invite the trade and they'd give you wine and come around on golf carts and get you drunk as you were hitting your balls around. It was a great, great thing, a real sort of establishment thing in New Zealand, in Wellington. But great wine, brilliant new winemakers just joined there, John Kavanagh, who used to work at Neudorf, and really exciting to have them on the table.
I love that wine, really bright, I would say almost dark cherry, raspberry kind of notes.
Really
on the palate.
Focused,
It is really focused, but a velvety finish, great with the venison we probably had tonight. And that ties into the next wine we have here, the Atarangi with Clive Payton and winemaker Helen Masters. And as we were talking about yesterday, I mean, he's legendary for his Pinot Noir throughout New Zealand. And the gumboot clone you were telling me about, talk to us about that.
Before I talk about the weird stuff about it, I've got to say how amazing I think this wine is. And also, you know, like these to me are the pioneers of Pinot Noir, along with a couple of others, consistently deliver right at the top of their game. And hence, they've got such a great reputation.
Right.
The gumboot clone is actually a clone of Pinot Noir that has been called Abel since then. And the story is a little complicated, but basically a guy was thought to have brought a cutting of a vine from the Domaine de la Romanée Conti vineyard. And he had it in his gumboot, let's say.
That's
a Wellington boot or a rubbish boot. I don't know. We call them wellies in England. But
wellies.
Wellington boots, wellies, you know. And so it was found at quarantine, this stick. And it went in quarantine and it got lost. And a guy called Abel, who worked in the quarantine department, thought, oh, I might grow that. So apparently he snuck it home, grew it, and it's become this clone that's widely planted. I mean, we're planting some next year. It's become widely planted all over New Zealand. And it's an amazing clone. It really is very, very different from all the others. So whether it came out of the Romani Conti Vineyard or Latesh Vineyard or wherever it was supposed to, I don't know, but it adds a lot to the diversity of New Zealand Pinot.
I love that wine. I don't know how many of you guys got a chance to try it while you're out there, but it has almost like a smoky bacon aroma to it, and you get that dark berry there, but then on the palate it's more of like strawberry jam a little bit from what I remember.
And a big potential for aging, I think, that wine.
Great potential for aging. And then so now we lead into our next two wines. The first one we have is Mount Difficulty. I know a good friend of yours, winemaker Matt Dicey, you're telling
Matt
me
Dicey.
Some good stories with that wine.
Yeah.
I love this wine.
I mean, they're certainly one of the most successful vineyards in that area. Again, you know, there's a pattern here. These are all pioneers almost, you know, and that's why they're at the top of the game, I'd say. The Dicey family have been involved in growing grapes down there for a long, long time, right at the beginning. Matt Dicey is one of the most lovely guys you could ever imagine. A really, really fun guy. He told me when I asked him, I said, I need something to talk about on screen. He said, well, you can tell them that took two kegs of craft beer to make that wine. He said, you know, and I love that as an idea. One was Epic, which is an amazing one. He even told me what they were. One was Emerson's Pilsner, which is a real stalwart of the New Zealand brewing industry.
So I'm curious, how many of you visited New Zealand? Has anyone been there actually before in the audience? Raise your hand. I know we had a couple people back there. You guys have been. So I'm sure you noticed the climate, the variations in the climate, no matter where you go. And what's interesting, tell us about the climate here. I know, because it's more, what they say, continental versus the maritime climate.
Yeah.
How does that affect the wine, do you say, a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, central Otago, it's kind of like continental climate is like a desert, let's say, in a way. So incredibly hot days and incredibly cold nights. They have the most amazing frosts. Where you see the frost hanging off all the trees and all the plants are like little crystallized things. Very, very cold. You've probably seen or heard of Queenstown and bungee jumping and boating and things like that. It's that an amazing extreme environment of mountains and lakes. And they have this incredible climate. And they make very, I think, specific wine styles to that. You end up with, you know, really hot temperatures during the day, really cool temperatures at night. I mean, you get beautiful ripe fruit, and then you get a really nice acidity to hold all that together, you know. So
you do, and on the nose, you still get that dark red and ripe berry notes. But I would say like a hint of, I was saying almost like Christmas, it reminds me of, like Christmas cake spice.
Yeah.
I really like that, and has a velvety finish too.
And am I allowed to talk about the other regions too, just quickly
yes,
while we're
can.
Here?
Yes, you can. I would love to compare, and well, we get into the last one, with Felton Road, before that. Oh,
before that, yeah. Okay,
me.
So just in terms of also the, and I should have said it before, but in terms of the Martinborough, you know, their wines are stylized by really great tannin, savory character, and that is a function of the weather there. Very much, it sits there with its valley kind of facing south a little bit, which is certainly a disadvantage in terms of weather sometimes, because when that cold wind comes off the Antarctic, it comes off the south, and it can whistle in there, a bit like in Wiper I was talking about before.
With the Pinot Gris,
and so it naturally devigorates the vine and allows, you know, and delivers a much lower crop.
Okay.
And hence the wines from Martinborough have that really spicy, beautiful tannin structure. I reckon more savory.
Yeah, it is, like the smoky bacon. That's what I was saying a little
and
bit.
Then I'm going to have to go to Marlborough quickly.
Yes,
as
no,
long as we've got
to.
Time, I'm sorry.
Yeah, we got plenty of time.
Okay, cool.
You're joining us all the way from New Zealand. We got time.
Marlborough sits the other way. So where you had this southern-facing kind of basin in Martinborough, Marlborough has the opposite, where it's protected from all that weather from all three sides, and its main river kind of flows northeast. So it's and all the bad weather comes from the west and the south.
Huh.
And so Marlborough has the consistent vintages in terms of we certainly have a lot of variation year to year, but we don't have that real devigorating kind of character that you get from Wiper and from Martinborough.
Got it.
So they certainly delivers the most consistent vintage. And Marlborough used to be the fruit bowl of New Zealand, so you can grow anything there really.
Oh, that's really interesting. And I guess that ties into our last Pinot we have here is the Felton Road.
Yep.
And with Nigel Greening and Blair Walton is the winemaker. Nigel joined us out here in Chicago a couple years ago. He's fantastic. But I know that they're really big on biodynamics and organic. We didn't really touch on that too much. Talk to me about that a little bit. That's huge in New Zealand.
Biodynamics is something that, in my eyes, is a bit supercharged organics. I'll talk about it in a sec. I think what's really exciting for New Zealand is that you can grow grapes organically there quite easily.
Right.
Certainly, you know, it's a leap of faith more than kind of practical problems that you have. It's a mentality thing. I know the figures. 2005, there were 45 hectares of certified organic land in Marlborough, and now there's 1,500 in the space of 7 years. New Zealand has this amazing charter to make 20% of their whole vineyards certified organic by 2020.
Wow.
I mean, at the moment, we're probably the highest percentage in anywhere in the whole world as we are, but we can really do it there. We have these beautiful fresh winds, we don't have a lot of disease, and it's really taking off. And you know, the exciting thing is that some of the big companies, the Villa Marias, you know, those sorts of people, they're also doing organics. And once the big companies get on board, then the whole thing just goes, and that's why it's so exciting. Biodynamics is another thing.
Tell everyone about that, because some people may not know. I mean, some people hear stories about planting according to the lunar cycles, planting cow horns. I know all this different crazy things.
Like I said already, you know, I consider it to be supercharged organics. Biodynamics is about a whole farm concept, a whole system, like a closed system of farming. Whereas organics, you know, you have rules that you can't spray things on the ground and you can't spray things on your canopy, which is wonderful. Biodynamics takes it to the next level where you have to do proactive things to the land. So you have to have animals on your property because it's about diversity. You know, you have to do positive things like take the manure, compost it, you know, mix it with water and spray it back out into the vineyard. You know, like I always like to say that you know, cow shit powers our vineyards, you know, that's it. Because that's all we use, that's all Felton Road would use.
Got it.
Some people get a bit scared of this whole, like, but so you get the cow shit and you bury it in this horn and then you bury it for 6 months and you dig it up and you spray it all over. Like, what the hell's that about? And I'd like to address that, you know, because, you know, in my eyes, that's the simple thing to explain. The cow ate the grass that it was living on, ate that, you know, some poor bastard has to go and pick up his shit after, I got to say. And that is a job that people do at our property. Like, what are you doing today? I'm picking up shit. No, just the normal guys that work in the vineyard, one day they'll have to go and collect poo, you know. But, you know, you think about it, it's a cycle. So the cow's eating the grass, the manure.
blend. We have the Cabernet Sauvignon Merlot blend.
Yeah.
And, with a little bit of Malbec in this one that we have here as well.
Yeah.
But, Sir George Fistinache was the founder, so back in 1961, but he's actually one of the pioneers of the New Zealand wine industry.
Yeah.
Great guy. Talk to us about Villa Maria and about Hawke's Bay, about the region of the wine.
Yeah. Villa Maria, I like to think of one of the real heroes of the New Zealand wine industry because, yeah, they have a lot of wines. They're a big company. They're owned by one family still. That makes a huge difference. There's no big, you know, guy behind there. I was going to mention the name of a big guy. I thought I might get sued in this country, so I better not. But it was an American company I was going to mention. Owned by one guy, and the passion, like, and they've been around like for 50 years now, as you say, and they've got holdings in most of the regions. They make a great diverse range of wines
right. At
different price quality. But they're all high quality, sorry. They're
right. Absolutely
all high quality. You always get value for money with a Villa Maria wine regardless. The Hawke's Bay, you know, they have one of the largest holdings in the Hawke's Bay special area called the Gimlet Gravels. And the Gimlet Gravels is this area. It's the first geographical kind of classification that ever that happened in New Zealand. And, amazing Cabernet Sauvignon, Merlot and Syrah come from there. It's this gravel bed that came from a big flood X amount of millions and billions of years ago. I don't remember when, obviously. But amazing, amazing wines from there. And, you know, that's definitely the key of the Hawke's Bay. This wine, 75% roughly Cabernet Sauvignon, 25% roughly Merlot with a touch of Malbec. Yeah, absolutely delicious, you know. And I mean, this wine you could put up against, you know, a good Cru Bourgeois, a Burgundy, Bordeaux, sorry.
Right.
You could really taste that up against a good Bordeaux, and I think it would really stand up well. That's delicious. 2007, it's really good.
And so we've got a great phenomenal lineup of whites and reds for you guys tonight. And if you're curious about more information about where to find all these wines, again, you can visit complexity.co.nz. Does everyone have a good time? Enjoy the wines, at least. I love it.
Cheers.
And the fresh Orking salmon, a bit of venison. Definitely a cheers to my co-host, Clive Dougall. Thank you so much, Chef Bill Kim. Thank you guys so much, and continue enjoying the wines for the rest of the night. We'll be here, and I look forward to seeing you guys again next year. Thanks to everyone watching us virtually, and as I always say, wine is just a conversation waiting to happen. Yeah. Cheers.
Thank you. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers.